I'm here.
Hi
Hi.
there, here.
Hi, 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 hi. I was in another thing and they ran over, so I apologize.
You're beautifully lit.
What was that?
You got great lighting.
Oh, thank you. I'm doing a lot of these now, so I've figured it out.
So you're doing well.
I'm good.
You're not minding this so much.
What's that?
You're not minding all of this insanity.
The quarantine and
the quarantining.
And, you know, I remind myself that I'm healthy, that my kids are healthy, my husband is healthy, my mom is healthy. I kind of stay away from her mostly. But we saw her for Christmas. She came over for the day, and we were fully, like, we basically had on masks the whole time she was there, but, you know, at least I got to see my mom. Like, some people can't see their moms. So I think where I am now is I'm just lucky to be healthy and, you know, still doing it, working, still being able to speak to people.
Are you working? Are you busy? Are you acting?
No, I'm not acting because I have a family. And so for me, the smaller jobs weren't a good idea because you'd have to go somewhere, quarantine for a number of, you know, sometimes 2 weeks, depending on where you're going, and then fly back to your family, quarantine from them. And I just felt like it was so much actual work to work. And then for a lot of my friends, they would start working and then their production would get shut down. I think that happened to, like, of all my friends who started working, it probably happened to 80% of the people I know. So to me, it was just so risky to actually enter into anything. I told myself I wouldn't really start doing anything until, you know, the year started, until 2021. And here we are now. So we'll see what happens. But yeah, I haven't been, I did one thing in quarantine with my family. I did the Netflix show, Social Distance, that we shot in quarantine, in my house, no crew, just me, my two kids and my husband were the crew. And then everything else was remote. The director was remote, you know, hair, makeup, everything was like, you know, I had to do via Zoom, camera, everybody, sound. That was crazy. It was great, but it was like, you know, it was a little, boy, I've never appreciated all the people on set before as much. I mean, I love all the people on set and I appreciate them, of course, but that was, talk about like new appreciation for every single person who's on a set when you actually have to do everything yourself. But other than that, I haven't gone on a set outside of, you know, my house.
And you are naturally a theater person.
I don't know if I'm naturally a theater
initially
person, but I started there. Yeah.
So, I mean, that's even more intimate, I'd say, than a set.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's funny. I kind of forgot. I did do a theatrical thing close to my neighborhood. It was walking distance from my house, which is why I did it. And it was a bunch of monologues about Black Lives Matter. We did it on, there's a Black Lives Matter mural near my house, and we did it outside on the mural, which was also why I did it, because we could social distance. We were in these glass boxes. All the actors were in these glass boxes. We did these monologues in isolation. Everyone wore their mask in rehearsal. So I actually did do that in September. I forgot about that, but I did, that did happen in September,
Errol Morris, the documentarian, but he also does commercials. And so he's actually shot a bunch of commercials from other states. But he is used to it. He created a box that called the Interatron, where the person speaks directly into the box and sees his face as there's a TV in the thing with his face on it. So it feels like he's talking to him, but you get direct eye contact.
Yeah.
And so for him, it was kind of like an easy adjustment to direct from directing shows in Chicago or commercials in Chicago from LA, from his house in Boston.
Oh, wow.
Not even thinking about it.
I mean, we've all learned to adjust to this, right? I did a voiceover in October, like an audio, you know, an audio play that was just me in a studio by myself and everybody else was somewhere else. And I had to do sound actually for I'm Your Woman. I had to do a bunch of ADR for I'm Your Woman. And I did it out of, I'm in my husband's studio now. And that's where I did it. And normally you would go in, the director may or may not be there, or they might be either physically in the room to give you direction on ADR, or they're on, you know, they're in their headphones or what have you. But yeah, I had to do it from home. So they just sent over a kit and I set this kit up. I didn't know what the heck I was doing, but you have to, it's like we learned all these new skills now in quarantine. I had to set up an audio kit and do it myself. And that's how we did all the ADR for I'm Your Woman. Everyone, it was somewhere else.
That's so you're ready to be a director now?
No. So here's a good thing. I think it's great to know that you can do it if you need to, you know, but it's also great to know that you don't have to do it. And that we're hoping for a time where we can go back to normal where someone else is doing it, because it's a lot of, it's just a lot of work. And if you're trying to be an actor, at least for me, some people can wear multiple hats. For me, I want to focus on being an actor. It's great, and it feels like such an accomplishment to say, like, oh my God, I did a show in quarantine, and I had to do my own sound, and I basically was directing myself and directing my kid, and I did all this stuff, and I had to do hair and makeup, and it's great. It's a great accomplishment. Is it something I want to continue doing? Absolutely not. It was more work than I'd ever done ever. And you want to have, you know, focus. It's like jack of all trades, master of none. I want to be a master of something. I don't want to just know how to do everything a little bit, you know?
It's funny, actors who direct sometimes will have that response to going back to work as an actor.
Yeah.
And they're you're like, well, isn't it weird to not want to tell everybody what to do? It's like, no, I'm really happy.
Happy just to be an actor. Yeah. Rachel was saying something like that earlier today. She said, because she's producer in our film, she's producer too on I'm Your Woman. Mm-hmm. And she said, what was really wonderful is you realize when you have to do both, you realize what a gift it is to just be doing one thing. Yeah. When you go back to just being an actor, you're like, oh my God, thank God that somebody else is making all these other decisions, you know?
So you go back a while with Rachel.
I go back to 2016. Yeah.
So was that part of how this all happened, that you ended up in this movie, or is that?
That's definitely how this happened. I mean, that's how we know each other. And if you speak to her, she swears that she never thought of anybody else as Terry other than me. She's like, I read the script. I saw Marsha Stephanie Blake and she pitched my name, and she did. She told me many, many months before I got close to even speaking to the director, to Julia Hart. Rachel and I went to see a play, and she said, I pitched you for this film. And in my mind, because I've been pitched, you know, all over the place by friends, by colleagues, by directors. To me, getting pitched by an actor doesn't really mean much, because usually the actor isn't in charge of those kinds of decisions, unless they're like a really top, you know, name actor. Mm-hmm. And so in my mind, I was like, that's really sweet. That's wonderful that you pitched me for this film. But like, you know, okay. Like, I didn't try to pursue it. I didn't like call her up and say, what's the movie? Or I didn't even ask her. I don't think I asked her like, what's the movie or what's it about? I just was like, oh, that's sweet. Thank you. And then we went to see the play, and it was not even spoken about again until the next time I saw her months later. And she was like, did I tell you I pitched you for this movie? And I was like, you told me. That's awesome. Thank you. Again, didn't know anything about the movie. Didn't realize she was a producer on it. And it wasn't until it came into my agency and I got an email that said, read for interest. And I saw her name and I saw that she was a producer. I was like, oh my God, this is real. Like, she really, this is the thing she's been trying to tell me for months, that she pitched me for this film. And I kind of was like, yeah. Let's go see a play. So yeah, it absolutely happened because we know each other. And I think the way we worked, because we were Desmond and Amelia together. Mm-hmm. And I think probably that also solidified in her brain this idea of, you know, women in a situation created by their husbands, where they kind of had to depend on each other, rely on each other, and really protect each other. And, you know, I'm Your Woman is not dissimilar to Desdemona. Terry and Jean and I'm Your Woman is not completely dissimilar to Desdemona and Emilia. So,
I would say that based on what we now know her from, that Rachel from, that Desdemona seems like a distant thing. Like, it's hard to imagine her playing
for
Desdemona.
For you guys, yeah, but not for me. Exactly. So for me, Maisel is more of a distant thing for me to see Rachel play Maisel. Because I remember she had, when we were doing Othello, she had done the pilot of Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. She hadn't done the whole, you know, they were waiting to know if they would get picked up at that whole rigmarole. Mm. And so I'd seen her be Desdemona. And then I watched Maisel and I was like, whoa, who is this person? Because that's not, you know, that energy, that life, that snappiness, that the comedy, that's not who I met. And I know Rachel in life can be funny, and she's funny, and she loves people who are funny, and she has a great sense of humor, right, and all of that. But like, that snappiness is not Desdemona. So for me, it was a complete departure to see her as Maisel. And actually, Jean is more in line with how I met her. The character that she plays in I'm Your Woman is more in line with, you know, the Rachel I know.
So apparently you read and you had interest.
Yes.
What was it like meeting up with Julia the first time?
I had a Skype conversation, was our first conversation. we mostly talked about our families. I forgot that I was talking to a director about a film I may or may not be a part of. We were both calling from home. You know, we were speaking to each other from home. So her kids, she has two children also. Yeah, she has two boys, I have two girls. So her kids were running around and being kids, and my kids were running around and being kids. And I kept having to move from room to room because they would invade whatever room I was in when I was trying to have the conversation. And then she kept having to do the same thing. And at some point in the middle of the conversation, I ended up talking to her son because he came into the room and I was like, let me get a chance to meet him. So our conversation was weirdly not even really about this film. It was about our lives, which when you think about it, it actually makes sense because so much about I'm Your Woman is about just these housewives who, you know, who are normal. And then they are put in extraordinary situations. And in Terry's case, she has figured a way out of that situation. But Jean, we're watching Jean figure her way out of it. Right. But for all intents and purposes, these are just moms, housewives, you know, who are thrown into something odd. So we just talked about being that. We just talked about our lives.
Well, it's funny. I don't imagine Julia doing things much. That's how I imagine it would work with her. Because she's so, you know, she knows you can act.
Yeah.
And then it's kind of like,
she'd watched my stuff, obviously. She'd watched like everything before we even had this conversation. She'd watched all my stuff.
Yeah. And then just probably was waiting to make sure that you were, you know, she wanted to spend the time with you.
Around me. Yeah. And honestly, I think that's such a big part of the business. Like, do you want to spend time with this person, intimate time, for 2 months straight? And yeah, if you already know the person can act, and I'd read her stuff at that point, I think I'd watched Fast Color and Miss Stevens. And I'm really good friends with Lily Rabe too, who plays Miss Stevens. Mm-hmm. So I think I maybe had a conversation with Lily about her. And at that point it was just, am I going to like this woman? Is she someone I want to be around for, you know, for 2 months? And I already knew I loved Rachel. So once I had the conversation with Julia, that solidified it for me that I wanted to be a part of this. And then we met Arinze, and Arinze is lovely and fit right in with everyone. It was like such a nice little family that we formed. But yeah, Julia is very just normal.
Well, except she's also amazing that, you know, she had the second kid she had on set.
Yeah, I mean, she's one of those people. She's like completely normal, seems like your next door neighbor, except she makes amazing films and is an incredible writer and director.
And she's a hard ass.
And she, yeah, and she can like really bring it when she needs.
You can do 8 months pregnant and while you're directing, it's a trick.
Yeah, no, we talked about that too, because I've done plays. I was pregnant with both my kids like on stage. And we talked about just like how people think, you know, moms are fragile, or especially pregnant moms are fragile. And she was just like, I've been pregnant on set. I directed, you know, I've been doing it. I've written when I had a baby right here, two week old baby. I'm writing, yeah. You know, rewriting a script. And I was like, I love this woman. I was like, I feel you. Yeah.
So is there a particular kind of role that you look for? Are you, I mean, obviously at this point you're still being sent stuff and, you know, it's not always choice. It's a lot of, some of it's auditioning.
I'm auditioning for, absolutely. Yeah. I still audition for lots of stuff. Most things. I think there was a point where I had made a decision that I didn't want to, I was doing this, a lot of it had to do with my life on stage. I was playing a lot of women who were deeply immersed in trauma at the time you meet them. And for me, I know that I don't easily separate like myself from the character once I'm in it. So for me, it was a lot of times going to these really intensely traumatic places, you know, play after play or after play, or like guest star after guest star, like all my guest stars were women who were, you know, in some real heavy shit. Mm-hmm. And then like, then I did When They See Us, which beautiful, like changed my complete career, you know, changed my life, changed my career. I love it. I love Ava. But, you know, even she is this woman, Linda McCrae, is in the middle of the most traumatic. It starts on the day her son gets arrested. So I kind of felt like, and on that set especially, or when I was working on When They See Us, I would have to leave. And this wasn't just me. This was most of us on set. We wouldn't be able to go straight home because we were taking so much of everything with us. And the fact that these were real people and some of them were on set with us. So we would cry together. We would like be in each other's emotional space all the time. The crew would be crying. You would look up from your heavy scene and you'd realize like, oh my God, my camera people are in tears or whatever. And so like just an intensely emotional time period. And I was just like, oh man, it would be so nice to just like do a comedy or like, you know, do something where like I'm a mom maybe, or I'm not a mom, but like my child isn't about to get arrested or dying or already dead, or my husband isn't in jail or my husband isn't a whatever. And actually what happened after When They See Us was I did How to Get Away with Murder, which, you know, the mom in that is going through some stuff with her son, but it's not super intense, right, dramatic stuff. And I get to kind of be a mom, a strong mom, but I'm good. I did This Is Us, again, a normal housewife with a great son. That was nice. And then I did I'm Your Woman. And it's like, Terry, maybe she's seen trauma, but when you meet her, she has dealt with it. Mm-hmm. And she has moved on with her life. And so I kind of get to be a completely different, stronger, more confident, more like present, empowered woman. And I love that about that script. I love that we were meeting Terry after the trauma.
Are you always carried your stuff with you as an actor? Is that something that's from the early days?
Am I always what?
Have you always carried your character with you?
And I don't know that that's the right way to be. I know some people can like get off set and like shake it off and move on. I was never that person. I mean, I don't think I'm Daniel Day-Lewis. Like, I don't need you to call me Mr. Lincoln, but there is something about if it's well-written, and I've had the, you know, the luck, the fortune, to have done some really well-written characters. And I do think if the character is well-written, it's hard to lose them when you're done, or it takes a while. I would have to walk around the city, you know, when I was playing Linda McCrae, I'd leave set and I wouldn't be able to go right home because I had little kids and I didn't want to bring that person home to them necessarily. This woman who was so like in emotional hell, because I have to be around them and they have to think everything's okay. And so I just walk around until I felt a little bit better. And I've done that many times playing women on, even when I was doing Amelia in Othello. Amelia, the end of Othello is Amelia like railing against Othello and then getting killed by her husband. Like, I can't just go home to my husband after that scene. I can't be like, hey, baby, what's going on? Like, no, I kind of have to like let it like ease its way out, you know.
Marion Cotillard would talk about having to spend like a month after a show or a movie or, you know, a couple, few weeks at least, really like not have the kids anywhere near a set and, yeah. you know, take a week or two after to try to drop the pain of the characters. You know, she plays these intense characters.
Absolutely.
And really hard time separating.
Yeah.
But again, not like Daniel Day-Lewis.
Right.
It wasn't like she was pretending. She was just carrying the emotion.
You're just carrying, yeah, it, because if you're really going there in those scenes, those intense scenes, and you're doing them, and, you know, with theater, it might be easier because you're doing it once a night, maybe twice on Saturdays and Sundays, but with film, you're doing take after take after take, and sometimes you're just like, you're stuck in it, whether you like it or not, whether you want to be or not, you're stuck there now because you just did 12 takes, you know, and yeah, you got to decompress after that kind of intensity. If you want to remain authentic and if you want it to be real each time, you have to go there. And then once you're there, you're stuck there for a little bit.
Yeah. Well, some actors do, you know, immediately start telling jokes as soon as the scene's over. But
I've tried that. I've done that. It depends. I've done that on stage. But that's usually because you just have to do the thing once.
Right.
And then I'll go backstage and I'll like try to like, you know, joke around with someone and sort of shake it off. It's harder to do with a film, I think.
Were you a kid who wanted to be a performer, or did you come into it some other way?
No, I came in through the back door. I came into it in a very odd way because no one in my family is a performer, or I didn't actually know this, but I have a cousin who was a performer in Jamaica, and my dad let us know that he was in a film when he was a kid. And I was like, what? I know. And in fact, I think it might've been even a James Bond film because they shot some of those on Jamaica. And it was, apparently it was a big film. He can't remember it.
Didn't let die.
He was a kid who fell out of a tree in, I think, a James Bond film. Who knows? Anyway.
Was it James Bond film, Live and Let Die? Was it Live and Let Die? Yeah.
It might.
With Otto and Jeffrey Holder.
That was shot on Jamaica?
In Jamaica. Well, also the first one. Was in Jamaica, but probably not with a kid falling out of a tree.
I don't know. It was.
You'd have to remember which Bond it was.
Was that?
You'd have to remember which Bond it happened to, because
he couldn't
Roger
remember.
Moore was the more recent one.
He couldn't tell us the name. And my father is not passed, but he said that they offered him. Listen to this craziness. They offered him either a car or a bike as payment. And he took the bike. He was a little kid.
He was too young to drive a car.
Imagine having to go home and tell your dad, who like doesn't have a car, that they offered you a car or a bike and you took the bike. I'm sure his dad wanted to kill him.
Magic beans.
I know. It's so crazy. I was like, and how evil are they that they offer this kid, you know, that they don't even speak to the parents. They offer this kid. This will give you context about when it actually happened. So it must have happened in like my dad was born in 45. So it probably happened in like the 50s or early 60s. He was very young. And they basically like bamboozled him.
It may have been Dr. No. It may have been that first one with Sean Connery.
It probably was.
Ursula Andress coming out of the water.
It probably, if they shot that in Jamaica, that's probably what it was. And
yeah.
They paid him with a bike. They owe me money.
at least the car.
You guys owe us money. So no one was a performer. It was college that I started acting, and just for fun, I was going to be a doctor. I had a friend who's still my friend now. She was actually my big sister in college. You know, you get assigned like a big sister. And she was really, really into performance and theater. She wrote plays and she was part of the drama department. And she was about to be in a play and take an acting class. And she was like, you should do this. This is fun. You gotta have some fun. And I took this acting class with her, ended up in the play with her. I had one line. And I loved it. By the way, I would get my line wrong. Like every other night, I would get my line wrong. I had one line. And sometimes I would clam up because I'd never performed in front of a big, you know, I would just clam up and like I had the first line in the play, and I would sometimes just freeze. The lights would go up, the curtain would go up, the music would go on, and I'd be like, and somebody would have to like whisper, like I'd hear my friend like, yeah, but I had one line. But I ended up loving the community that was formed around that and just how everyone just seemed like they were having a great time, no matter what was going on. So I did another play.
Were you a super serious kid?
I was very studious. So I was like valedictorian. I read every book. I have an older sister, so I read all her books. So I was very well read by the time I got to, by the time I was 8 years old, I was reading like Toni Morrison and just very intense, heavy, emotional books. It's funny because my favorite book is Beloved, and Julia Hart's favorite book, Beloved.
There you go.
I know. We were like, once we found that out, we were like, okay, we are meant to like do something. Like we have been in each other's orbit
for a long time.
Yeah. I was a pretty intense kid, I would say. I read a lot. I was a little bit of an introvert. I would go to parties, but I'd be the person in the corner reading a book. I was that person. Mm. And then I don't know how I became like an actor, because you would never, I don't think anyone would have guessed it.
Well, it sounds like you fell in love with it. I mean, you often hear about people who, that first laugh or that first moment, that connection,
yes,
stays with them, and that's what drives them forever.
Yeah. And my line in that play was a laugh line. Like I said, I wouldn't always get the laugh because I wouldn't always get the line out correctly. But maybe I feel like the first day it really worked and it like clicked for me, I was like, whoa, that felt amazing. I want more of that. And so I just kept doing all these plays in college, mostly because of my friend. And the next thing I knew, all I was doing, I was spending a lot of time in the theater department,
And did you go to New York? Were you in New York? I don't know where you're from, but.
I'm from New York. Well, I'm originally from Jamaica, moved to New York. Mm-hmm. So after college, I came back to New York briefly, and then I went out to grad school. I went to UCSD for an MFA once I decided I was going to be an actor for sure. I still thought there was a point, and I still do think I will eventually write, because I love stories so much. And I did think when I graduated Dartmouth, I did think, even though I was such an actor at that point, I'd acted in a bunch of stuff, I did think that probably what I would end up doing was writing. Thought I'd be a playwright. And I wrote a play for my thesis. So I kind of was always thinking I'd write.
And you chose UCSD because it was warm after Dartmouth?
You know what? You're joking, but that kind of was a big part of it. I was just like, I can't. I remember I went to Yale to check out their MFA program. And then it was between Yale and NYU and UCSD. And I have to tell you, David, like it came down to after Dartmouth, freezing my ass off for 4 years, where there were some days where they would say it's minus 16, but it feels like minus 60. Like, that's crazy. I was like, am I really going to do that again? I remember, and the day I had my audition at Yale, there was a big snowstorm, big. And I was late because I couldn't get to the studio. And I was like, I'm not doing this. I can't do this another. I can't. I'm UCSD all the way. Yeah, totally.
A lovely
place. I'm glad I did it. What's that?
San Diego's a lovely place.
So beautiful.
Maybe the best weather in America.
Oh my gosh. I live near 5 different beaches. Like I could just throw a rock and like hit a different beach. Like it was, I would go watch sunsets and sunrises and oh my goodness. Amazing. I love that.
And when did you turn pro?
When did I turn? When I got out of school, I came back to New York. Naturally, because I had no money. So I just went back to live with my parents. That year I booked a Broadway show. Like it was like one of my first, it might've been my first real job with like an equity card in my hand. I went to an equity open call. So no agent, I didn't have an agent. I had people who were interested, but I hadn't signed with anyone. And I went to an open call because my friends told me something was happening, and I got this part to be an understudy in The Crucible on Broadway with Liam Neeson and Laura Linney, which, like, hello? Liam Neeson, Laura Linney, my first play! And that was, like, the start of my career in New York. Like, what a start, right? It was ridiculous. I couldn't believe my luck.
You have really good friends.
Well, I was going to say, by the way, my friends who invited me to come to this audition, they did not get the part. They were so mad. They were so mad at me. They were like, you didn't even know about this. And then you show up and you get the part. Yeah. So they're lovely friends, and they're still some of my best friends. But that was my first pro job.
Yeah. I don't remember who told the story about they went to an audition with their sibling. And they were just there because they were in New York or whatever. And they ended up auditioning and got the role. And the sibling
never acted again. There's so many stories like that. I think Mekhi Phifer is one of those people. Like he showed up with one of his friends when they were doing Clockers, when Spike Lee was doing Clockers. And he just showed up to be like, oh, I'm going to see what this is about. And then they were like, how about you? He was like, what? I'm not an actor. And then he ends up getting like the lead. It happens so often. Yeah.
So did being Black make a big difference in terms of those early years of, I mean, it sounds like it was, things were opening up a little bit more by the time you started working.
I don't know. I mean, they were doing The Crucible. There's one Black person in The Crucible, and that's Tituba. And so I was understudying the woman who was cast as Tituba. And then I wouldn't say it was easy. It was definitely easier for me to navigate the theater world. But also, once you're in a Broadway play, you get to meet a certain, you know, level of people, and people are willing to call you into their audition rooms. And then you just have to, like, you know, be good to keep sort of moving in that direction. So I pretty consistently worked in New York from then, because I think my play after that Crucible, the Broadway play, I did Shakespeare in the Park, which is also another very prestigious sort of, you know, thing to do in New York. But I had both those jobs. I remember I was like doing Crucible at night, and in the daytime I was rehearsing Shakespeare in the Park. So I immediately was like in the New York sort of theater world, and people were getting to know who I was. And so that was easy. Definitely then we were still at a point where there weren't a lot of productions in New York. So there wasn't a lot of TV. There were like the Law and Orders and Third Watch, you know, remember that show? What's that?
I do.
Yeah, Third Watch. Like, and remember?
You were too late for...
We had like three shows in New York.
Equalizer was before your time.
Oh my gosh. The kids coming out of school now, I'm like, you guys have no... I'm like the old lady who's like, I had to walk 40 miles to school. They have no idea. We had three shows in New York. And if you guest starred on a Law & Order, because they didn't even have all the Law & Orders that they have now. They have like all these different ones. But if you had guest starred on it, you had to wait like 6 years before you could guest star again.
Like dying. Like being claimed dead when you disappear.
Or exactly. Like you... I mean, we had the most limited number of shows. So yeah, I wasn't, and I never really wanted to move to LA. And I just didn't, I, you know, I'm a New Yorker. I wanted to stay in New York, and I was working pretty consistently, like I said. So I wasn't ever feeling like, oh my God, I need to find work. I never had to wait tables or anything. I had side jobs. I definitely temped, but I had great friends from Dartmouth who would hire me. I had these amazing best friends who they're still like my closest friends. And they all came out of Dartmouth a little bit earlier than I did, years before I did. And they had established jobs at that point by the time I came out. So I worked for one of my friends at People Magazine. And then I had another friend who was at InStyle. She was like associate art director at InStyle Magazine. I worked for her. Like, you know, I would get these, like, they would just fold me into whatever, because they also very supportive of my career. So if they felt like I had a dry season or whatever, they'd just be like, come be my temp. I need a temp. Half the time, I don't even think they needed a temp. Like, God bless them. But they would just like fold me into whatever corporate gig they had. And with the knowledge that like you get a gig, you go be an actor. So I had incredibly supportive friends. It's the only way. I don't know, like, there's so many people who are responsible, weirdly, for getting me to where I am now. Like seriously, this is a tough gig. This is a tough thing to decide to be an actor and like keep at it when you're getting rejections and all that other stuff every day.
So is there a point where you felt like, okay, now I'm on my way?
That probably happened several times where I had a little bit of a boost. I mean, it's weird, like this business is heartbreaking in that you can have those moments and then like, you know, a month later you feel like, oh my God, I'm back where I was 2 months ago and now I don't know what's going on. I'd done a couple of Broadway plays. I did one where, you know, the New York Times, I did not get nominated for a Tony, but the New York Times printed that I should have been nominated for a Tony. That's always nice. And you know what I mean? Like they, you know, the New York Times was a big deal. And just getting your name in the paper saying like, we think this person should have been nominated.
Right.
And that was the same year, like Tony Kushner gave me an award for like, I think it was, ironically, I'd been doing theater for 7 years and it was like newcomer, best newcomer. I was like, but you know, so that was that same year. And so I felt like, all right, I'm on my way. This is it. And then, you know, then nothing. Or you're back to maybe doing an off Broadway show, which is great. But that you're like, oh man, I thought I was like going this way and I'm back to the plateau. And then like I was my very first big movie audition, they were looking at me for the lead. Like I went from never really being in a film or being a small part in an independent film to auditioning for Django and auditioning for the lead in Django and like meeting Quentin Tarantino and being flown to, first I was flown to, I think New Orleans to meet him. Mm-hmm. And then he flew me because they were doing pre-production in New Orleans or something like that. And I met him in New Orleans. And then he flew me to LA to meet some more people, you know, to audition again. And I didn't get the part. I didn't get the lead. Kerry Washington ended up getting the lead. But I got a part in that film. I had one scene with Christoph Waltz and Sam Jackson. And I'd done one of my Broadway plays with Sam's wife. So I knew Sam. So I come on the set and Sam Jackson's like, ladies and gentlemen, it's Marsha Stephanie Blake. She's one of the greatest actresses I know. And I get this welcome and I'm like, yes, Hollywood, here I come. I'm on my way. And then my scene gets cut from Django.
Sam's still angry about one of the scenes that got cut from Django. He actually, there's a scene with Jamie Foxx hanging upside down naked where Sam was torturing him with a knife.
Yes.
He was very upset that got cut.
It got cut.
Yeah.
But at least he had other scenes.
He had a lot of other scenes. He was amazing.
He had a lot of other scenes.
He wanted to be meaner.
he actually was mean to my character too in my scene. And I kind of know why it was cut. It was a little repetitive. But man, you think you're in like a big block and you know, you tell my husband when I told everybody we know, which I never do. Cause you know, you can get cut. But he was so excited. He told everybody, oh, we're going to go watch Django Unchained. Everybody goes the opening of Django Unchained and I am not.
Oof.
So yeah, there were a lot of moments of me feeling like I'm on my way, Hollywood.
There's a big thank you at the end of, Casualties of War, the Terry Malick war movie, to Adrian Brody, who was the lead of the movie when the movie started.
Yeah.
And they basically cut almost his entire part out by the movie. So he thought he was like the star of the movie and like he was in one or two little scenes.
Oh my God. Oh, but see, that's worse. I know it's more likely, like if you're going to get cut and you have one scene, then you're like, all right, I had one scene. But if you're the star, oh my God, at least he went on to win an Oscar.
Yes, he did.
He got his.
He made it back somehow.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, no, it's the most terrifying thing. And that's why actors are superstitious. And that's why we don't tell anyone. I mean, my friends to this day, they'll see something. They'll see an ad for something I'm in and they'll be like, what? Why wouldn't you tell us you were in a freaking And I'm like, because you guys, do you remember Django? I'm like, remember the Django experience? I am shell-shocked from that. I still have PTSD from that.
Leaves a mark.
It does. So until I see it myself and the final cut, this is what we're sending to festivals or this is what we're sending to the network or the studios, until I see that and make sure I'm in it, you will never hear from me that I'm in it. It just won't happen. And with TV shows too, like, I am not going to tell you I'm in a TV show until I have spoken to production and know that my scenes are still in this show.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's tough, but to answer your question in a sort of roundabout way, it's happened a bunch of times. And then, you know, the Emmy nomination, of course, with When They See Us is one of those times I had actually quit acting right before that.
Huh.
Yeah.
What was that about?
I told myself I quit. I feel like we never really quit. We're like, I quit until something amazing comes along.
Right.
And then I'm going to unquit. And that's kind of where I was.
So you were happy with your family and your life and your real life.
And I had done a lot of the similar kinds of roles. I'd done Broadway. You know, I'd been on a good little career path. And then I felt like I'd plateaued a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I couldn't get seen for things that I really wanted to be a part of. No one really knew my name. I was still a New York actor in many ways. And even though I'd done a couple of things, like I'd done Loose, which I was really proud of. I'd done Rosemary and Loose and, you know, things that I felt really proud of. And I was like, you know what? I'm good. I have an MFA. I can go write. I've always wanted to be a writer. I can go do that. And I could always, while I'm writing, I could teach because I have this master's, you know, I have a degree. I'm like super degreed, which my family insisted on. But, you know, I felt comfortably in my own skin and in my life. And I went on vacation with my family. And it was one of those, like, a real vacation. It wasn't a vacation like, if I get work, I got to fly back, which has happened on every single vacation I've ever taken as an actor. I always have to fly back early. So this was one of those vacations where, like, I had no plans to fly back early. Nothing was on the table. I was like, I'm out. I'm good. I told my reps, if anything comes across that you guys really think, like, I really have a shot at, and it's, you read it and you're just like, this is Marsha Stephanie, then please send it. But understand that I'm going on a real vacation and I'm good. I'm okay. We're fine. You guys have done well for me. Thank you. But and my main agent in my agency was retiring that year also. And I kind of felt like we had come to a sort of an end. And maybe this was a time for me to, like, reassess everything and figure out what I was going to do next, kind of thing, because he was leaving too. And I went away and I was in Colorado when they sent me When They See Us. And they didn't even send me the whole script. I just knew the story because I was a New Yorker. I'd come from Jamaica in the 80s. And I remember the Central Park Five. I remember that story. I remember it being on the news. And I remember being traumatized as a young Black kid in New York and my brothers being told not to go to the park and the seriousness of it. And I was like, oh, and then, oh, it's being done by Ava DuVernay. I was like, oh my God, this is gonna be special, you know? And so even more than me being a part of it, I was just happy it was being done, you know, just as a piece of art. I was just like, oh, it would be so beautiful if they told this the right way, if these men got to tell their side and just all of that. And I was so proud that it was happening in my lifetime that I'd get to see it. And then, so I was like, yeah, I'll totally put myself on tape for that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't expect to get it. I thought, you know, they would pepper it with names. I could totally see them doing that because why not? I thought everybody would be interested in playing these parts. So I was like, what are the chances that I am going to be? But I did put myself on tape. I sent my tape in. And when I got the call back, I remember talking to my reps about, because this often happens, like you'll get a call back, then you find out like 20 people have been called back. They're looking at 20 people. So I said, you know, I'm not home and I can't get to this call back. anytime soon. It will be really expensive for me to fly back home to New York. The callback was in like 2 days. Mm-hmm. And I was like, unless I'm a real consideration, I'm just going to let it go because, right. If it's me and 30 other women and they're just seeing people again for the second round, like, I'm not interested in that. I want to know, does Ava really know who I am? Did they really watch my tape? Did they really give this any attention? And not in an arrogant way, just in a real way. I've been in the business long enough. Like, how real is this callback, right? And Ava had seen me in Othello. Mm. That Othello I did with Rachel Brosnahan also had David Oyelowo playing Othello. And so Ava had, sat in this very intimate little tiny off-Broadway theater in New York and watched me be Amelia at the end of the play. So she didn't know who I was. And they called her, they talked to her or her people and made sure that she actually had information about me that was more than just my tape. Because it does take more than that.
Yeah.
And then I still said I couldn't fly back to New York because it was too expensive. So I was like, I can't go to the callback. And she agreed. She was like, well, can she fly to LA? Is it cheaper for her to fly to LA? Mm-hmm. And she agreed to meet me in LA. And it was cheaper. My flight was $86.
Wow.
I did have to go through like Texas. It was like the most roundabout way to go from Colorado to LA. I had to go like to LA. But my husband found me this ticket. And I remember going to him and I couldn't find a ticket from Colorado where I was. I was in Vail to LA and it was so expensive. And I remember going to him and being like, oh my God, she made this concession. She wants to see me in LA and I can't go. I'm not going to be able to go. And I was like practically in tears. Like, I can't believe I'm going to have to let this go. And my husband was like, go sit down. Let me do this. And he was like, miles. Let me try with this credit card and this miles and this thing and that thing. And he found me this $86 ticket.
Wow.
I know. It was really like, but he's that guy. Like when I start spiraling out of control, he's like, okay, drama queen, go sit over there somewhere. Let me do this. Came back. He was like, you fly tomorrow. You don't have to go. I thought I'd have to go to Denver to get to. He was like, you fly out of Eagle. You go, you do have a layover in Texas. But then, or I can't even remember. Maybe it was Phoenix. Right. And then the day I flew in was the day I had my callback with Ava. And she offered me the role in the room. And that completely was like. And at the end of that summer, this is a lesson to any actor listening to this. Maybe you have to quit. at the end of that summer that I quit acting, I had 4 legit jobs. Like not like a little guest star here or whatever. Like I had 4 real acting jobs. Like 4 at the end of that summer. And one of them was When They See Us.
Well, sometimes when you decide you don't want it anymore is when it shows up,
No, it's like you let it go and you're like, I'm good.
Yeah.
And then it decides to come back.
Well, I think that your real life speaks to, your acting is obviously very impressive and your work has been great and a pretty wide range of stuff. And at the same time, you as a human being seem even more impressive to me, frankly.
Oh.
The fact that you have
your
friend.
You. I'm more interested in being a good human being than I am in being a good actor. So thank you.
Well, the kind of lifetime of your friendships and the fact that they've been so supportive of you speaks incredibly well of you. Mm. And your passions, all make sense. You're actually, you seem to be, it's not a, sometimes people get that narrow focus.
Yeah.
And lose their perspective. And you clearly have not, which is kind of wonderful.
Oh, thank you, David. I appreciate that. Cause I do think, maybe it works for some other people, but I think being a good actor also means you have to be a good observer of life. You can't, you have to sort of let experiences in, experience family and go take the vacation and have the temp job. Like, how are you going to play a temp if you've never temp? You know what I mean? Like, so much of it is informs our work that
yeah.
I do think it is important to just be a human being. Yeah.
Well, every journey is so different. I mean, it's I've been doing this a long time, and you know, there were a few thousand of these interviews around, and you know, every story. I mean, there are things that connect sometimes, but it's a lot. It's the same as any, I guess, other any individual you talk to. You know, you pick off the street has a story that's much more complex and interesting than you realize when you see them walking by.
I always say normal people are fascinating. And you don't think so until you sit down and talk to them. I have this theater company that I work with called The Civilians, and a big part of our work is documentary style theater. And we just interview usually something around a subject, but we just interview regular people. And oh my gosh, you should hear the things we get out of just regular people, folks living their lives. The most fascinating. I have one coming up, actually. We're doing a Black Lives Matter sort of exploration. And I have an interview that I have to conduct with one of the women who, she became one of the iconic photos of the movement. This black and white photo of this black woman with her hand up holding a sign. And I'm going to interview her probably later this week. And I can't wait, because the things you find out, it's not like, it's never the moment that gives them the notoriety. It's everything that leads up to that. It's like, how did this person, this normal person just living their normal life, get to be this iconic figure, this representation of a movement, you know?
And then you convert that to a stage piece, or it's the interview stage piece?
We convert it to stage. I mean, now who knows what we're going to do, because like, what stage anymore?
Right.
At least right now. We've never done a filmed piece because we are a theater company specifically, but I don't think it would be hard to do. It's more, I guess the familiar thing that you guys would know with this like Laramie Project, that they converted into a filmed piece. But yeah, we talk to regular people, and then we use their interviews. We don't change their words. Again, this is where my writing comes in. We all write together, and we we theatricalize it in a way that makes sense, that has, you know, an arc and all of that stuff. And we usually add music. It's not a musical, but it's like play with music, right? Our musical director passed away a few years ago, so now we're, I'm not sure, I haven't done one yet without him. He was a big part of my life in this theater company, because I don't sing, but he would write songs for me. Like, he wrote me a solo. And it's one of those things where he wrote me a solo, and he was like, Marsha Stephanie, for some reason, he loves how I sound when I sing. I sound horrible. But for him, because he was so interested in just, again, we're talking about normal, ordinary people. He didn't want me to sound like a Broadway singer. He wanted me to sound like a woman who's telling the story, who might break into song, or a man. I often would play men too. I've played actually probably more men than women. And he wanted me to just sound like the person. So he was like, I don't care if you don't know how to really carry a tune. And then the worst thing, that for someone who's so nervous about singing, he wrote me a solo, and I had this big solo number in our last show. It was crazy. So yeah, we don't.
You made it work.
I did. I did. I mean, it's like a talky song. You know what I mean? It's one of those.
You ready for My Fair Lady?
No.
Gender reversed My Fair Lady.
No.
You can do the Rex Harrison thing.
I'm not ready for anything that people will come and be like, what is she doing? Nothing that's familiar to other people. No.
I saw the Laura Benante when she took over for somebody else, but she went on Broadway last couple years ago. And the guy could sing. The guy playing Henry Higgins could actually sing. And I'd never seen that before, because I'd seen Rex Harrison do it.
Oh, and he always was talking. Oh, really?
Yeah.
I think people are more forgiving with men, though. I think people will forgive men if they can't necessarily like sing. But especially, I'm a black woman who can't sing. People expect David, you know I'm telling the truth.
Let's break this.
People expect black women to be able to sing. And I'm always like, I'm the black woman who can't sing. I'm that one.
But I bet you, can you dance? A little bit.
I mean, I'm not a dancer. I'm definitely a better dancer than I am a singer. But I'm not, listen, I'm an actor. I'm not a triple threat. I don't want to be a triple threat. I'm a single threat, if you want to call me that.
Hey, a good single threat is a solid, important thing.
Exactly.
Of course, what's his name? My Fair Lady. He had a flatulence problem also, so that was another issue.
Oh, no!
He was famous for his flatulence.
Oh, no, that's a threat you don't want.
So it would happen on stage often. And the actor,
no, are you kidding? Yeah.
No.
Wait, is any of this documented? Can I watch it on YouTube?
No, it's not. You can't tell in the movie.
Oh, you can't tell. Okay.
But on stage, he was famously flatulent.
Oh.
And would just walk around dropping him all over the place as he did the show.
Oh, my God, how awful.
Yeah.
The other actors to pretend like nothing's going on.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Your mouth is wide open singing. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh.
So he was a multiple threat. It was really a threat.
Yeah, that's an actual real threat. Yeah.
Well, it's a pleasure meeting you.
You too.
I've only known you through your work up until now. And I actually been always anxious to see the Oyelowo Daniel Craig Othello. So I didn't get to see it.
Did you get a chance to see it in New York? No.
No, sadly.
Maybe we'll be able to do it again when the world opens up.
Yeah.
He was wonderful. And Daniel Craig played Iago. So I was Iago's, I was Daniel's wife. So everyone came. This is why Ava was there. Like Oprah came to see that. Yeah. Everybody who was anybody came to see that performance. It was insane. But they were both fantastic. David and Danielle were, and very, pared down because we were in a tiny theater. So they couldn't be like, it wasn't on Broadway. And
right.
Danielle specifically,
I remember trying
not
to get
it on a Broadway stage. It was a 200 seat theater.
Yeah.
It was, one of the best experiences of my theater career, for sure.
Someday I want to see David play Iago.
Yes.
I think he'd be great at that too.
He would be great at Iago. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Of course, now he's directing.
He's good.
Go figure. He is a very good actor.
And a sweetheart. And talk about somebody else who's like, he has his, he has like four kids. Like, he's a very well-rounded, sort of just regular dude who happens to be a fantastic, award-winning actor too. Yeah.
Well, people who are outside of the, who aren't actually working on the set don't know that always. And it's a fascinating thing because you can forget people are humans at times. And it's, it's got good parts and bad parts, but it's weird when I've always, my favorite interviews are almost always character actors because they're human. They're the most human. They figured out that it's a job, that it's, it's fulfilling in a certain way, but there are other things that may be more important in the world.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And it's a working actor is an amazing thing to be.
Yeah, for sure. I consider myself very lucky, for sure.
Well, luck and talent are a good combination. And if not, you'll just write some more stuff.
I'll just write
yourself the best role ever.
That's right.
And then you can tour forever with it. Like,
right.
I don't know. One of those shows. It's been lovely. Happy New Year. I'm glad everybody is healthy on your end of the world.
Thank you, Mija. Yes,
exactly.
I pray for everyone, always. It's a rough time to be alive, but
yeah,
good to actually be alive, to actually be able to say that.
Well, everybody I know in New York who died early. I have not, it's really, it's weird. Like I know four or five people who went pretty much in those first few months.
Yeah.
And it's been quieter since. And I'm like, thank God. Now we're having another wave that's problematic. But
I know. I'm worried about the second wave. But, I think being in New York, even though it's such a populated place and you feel so, overwhelmed, you walk out the door, I think New Yorkers have figured it out to a certain extent. In my neighborhood, we are taking care of each other. There are definitely people wearing their masks. There are definitely people social distancing and not overcrowding any store. The stores are keeping it to six people at a time. We're following the rules. And I think, because like you said, we saw early on so many people go that we realized how serious it was really quickly.
Yeah.
So I'm proud of New Yorkers for where we are right now, actually.
I'm equally embarrassed by California, but that's a whole other
thing. I know. That's another story. I don't know.
We can't even really understand why it's so bad here. But it is. I mean, it's extraordinary.
California, which went like everyone, for what I know of LA, was that everything was so isolated. Like people didn't even get out of their cars.
Right.
And now everybody wants to get out of their car. Like what's going on?
Yeah. Well, it's amazing how many shows, you know, they've been very quiet about how many shows have shut down.
They start, yeah. That's
but the they thing. Started, they start, month, and then you know, they... early December, there were shows shutting down.
Yeah.
Out here, television stuff. And then those lots have become kind of problems. There's certain lots that are worse than others.
Oh, no.
So it's been, you know, and I write about this stuff, but I don't, because I'm not really interested in being the, you know, going around being the bearer of bad news.
Right. And our industry is so, everything is so connected. Like, talk about all the people on set who are all connected and who you see who come in and out of.
Well, how many people people forget how many people on a sitcom there are. You know, there are 85, 90 people working there every day.
It's impossible to keep. I don't know.
Yeah.
Our industry has been hit so hard. It's crazy.
Wow. Let's hope that Mr. Biden speeds up the inoculation process and we'll get on with it.
Back to work.
Better things in the summer. Let's hope.
Yes, I am hopeful. I actually am hopeful. I am.
Me too. I don't have as nice, my nails aren't as nice, but I don't.
I am hopeful.
Very lovely.
Thank you.
Thank you so much again. Appreciate it.
Yes, you too. It's so wonderful to meet you and to chat with you. Thank you.
And someday in person. I'll look forward to it.
Oh, I would love that.
And I'll have a haircut so I can, you know, not wear my...
I keep the beard, though. I like the beard.
Well, we'll see. We'll see how long it lasts this time.
All right, David. So good to meet you.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.